permaculture is a social construct that integrates humans back into the biophysical limits of this planet. It is a scientific-based design system that integrates humans back into natural succession. Most social constructs on this planet are political or religious in nature and separate us from these biophysical limits. We exist in this condition only because of hierarchy and the over-harvesting of resources. It's not reality. It's not sustainable. It will not continue. There is an end. Much like the Holy Bible, which is a blueprint for hierarchy, how to establish a hierarchy, how to establish this alternate reality. And of course, the last chapter of the Holy Bible talks about how it all collapses. And it's because of the over-harvesting of all these resources. We're way over the planetary limits right now. And I'm not here to tell you permaculture is going to save anything or there's going to be any type of a system or any type of a movement, brutal or not, that's going to change human behavior. I'm not here to tell you any of that's going to happen. We're going to continue to over-harvest resources until we can't anymore. Then the entire social construct that is the alternate of reality is going to collapse. But what permaculture can be to you, it is for me, it's a means to escape this alternate reality that is not sustainable. I've got it all over my backyard. And I've also done some, I've got experience with some broad acres. And because of this experience, I can tell you that we can do it. And there are designs that can make life rather easy even without all this technology, but we're not going to be getting there anytime soon. So this is a perfect opportunity to blend the two, the alternate reality, the overharvest of resources, and then you're channeling some of these resources into your permaculture design, which if you amortize it over time is really a very small part of this over harvest. And at some point you overcome the resource investment and your system begins to produce way more resources than it took to produce the design. So I planted some Cornelian cherries yesterday. I'm going to review my areas here. I'm actually wishing I never planted an apple tree because they're so labor intensive. Or maybe I'll cut them all down and replace them with varieties like this. This is a Cornelian cherry that has very little pests and disease. And this one is a Red Dawn. I planted it here. I had a yellow cherry tree growing here, and all of a sudden I have an opening. Oh boy, you can't even see that opening here. All of a sudden I got an opening here because that red cherry or that yellow cherry was girdled by rabbits last winter. So I put a Red Dawn here. And I got a Red Star over here where that cherry tree actually was. So I transitioned from what people would consider real cherries into these Cornelian cherries. That's that. Let's dump it in here somewhere right there. That's where the
factory was just getting ready to go to.
Which, those cherries also have a pretty vicious pest, that kirk beetle. But these Cornelian cherries, I have no idea. I don't know of any pests that bother these cherries. And the seeds are long, long and narrow. So the birds don't like eating them.
I put another one way back here. I had the plum trees are another one that I wish I never planted. That kirk beetle really does a number on them too. And plus there's too much fructose in them. That fructose from those large fruits, they go directly to your liver. And then you get what's called non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So here's where I put this Cornelian cherry. I had a plum tree here that actually broke. So we're gonna replace it with a Cornelian cherry. Elegant. This is supposed to be a really big fruit.
This is a patch of imperial white currants mostly. They're getting ready to be picked. I'm just gonna sit here and eat. Everything is wet right now. I've got some red currants. There's some jostaberries in here. This is my asparagus, mixed planting asparagus and rye area. That since I'm on the subject, I might as well tell you that this side was mostly ribes with just a few asparagus, and asparagus are largely disappeared. And this side was, the ribes were more spaced out. And here we have asparagus. There we have a nice shot. Oh, we gotta go check those other Cornelian cherries. The perfect weather, we've been having 80 degree temperatures and dry conditions. And all of a sudden, the jet stream switched and we're getting cool conditions and rain. 61 degrees right now. That's Fahrenheit for you Europeans who are watching this. But perfect time to plant trees. So I'll just make sure they get 2 gallons of water every once a week. Even if it's raining, I'm going to do it, because the rain isn't, these aren't really soaking rains. So then I have this is a Cornelian cherry I planted about 5 years ago. And the rain, the weight of the rain has made it sag. But that's okay, it'll grow another lead here and grow up straight. But here's another one of those cherries that I planted yesterday. Right here. It's next to another, just a red osier dogwood here. So it's all in the family, right?
If the red osier dogwoods grow well, you're going to have good yellow cherry, yellow Cornelian cherry growth.
And I got some pawpaws here. So this will be pawpaws and Cornelian cherries and kiwis. And here's the other one.
Back in this one, a pioneer. Pioneer.
This one had the most side branches. So this was the area that gave me the idea I want to get some more Cornelian cherries. I want to put another one here next to this. I think it's called a Swarovski. And I have a full-grown one. That's the top of it right there. And I'm hoping that this one actually blossoms next year, one of these two, so that we can pollinate that big one. That big one probably had 1,000 blossoms on it this year. Just think, I just planted 8 new Cornelian cherries, and I probably already have 7 or 8 on the property. Oh, they'll start producing, holy cow. What am I gonna eat first? And then I have a special one over here, but it was kind of broke. The fellow I bought it from, he only had 2 of them, and he didn't want to sell it to me. And I kind of gave him no choice, you know. Man, you got to sell me one of those. I'm here to buy. So he did.
I like it because it's a early, yellow early. It's an earlier producer. And it was broke right here. He gave me the one that it was kind of broken. He patched it up with some grafting tape. But I went ahead and I stuck a stick in the ground and gave it some support. But it's in the afternoon shade. It'll get some morning sun. And afternoon shade, that'll be good for it here. So I see dogwoods growing in total shade. And this should be a good spot. I like it. This is my composting area. So it'll be growing with hazelnuts, and there's a peach tree right on the edge, and there's an apple tree in there, there's a plum tree in there. There's a honey locust you can see over the top. I mean, there's a little bit of everything in that little patch. It'll be part of that patch right here on the edge. I got two more. Where did I put those? Oh, yeah. Two smaller ones. I'm zipping this camera around. I'm probably making your eyes all buggy looking at this thing. Well, I don't have very many subscribers or viewers anyway, so I won't screw too many of you up. So I've got two smaller ones here. These are little hugel culture complexes here. And here's one of them. I got a blueberry here. I planted a whole lot of blueberries on this, and I've been putting sulfur in it, and they just don't grow. It's been that size for 5 or 6 years already. I get 3-4 berries out of it every other year. But there's some sea buckthorn on these hugel cultures. These happen to be Russian oranges. So we're going to be adding Cornelian cherries. And the last one is over here, right there. Coral blaze. There's a nice opening here for it. So this is other Cornelian cherries in here. I've got seedlings. There's 4 or 5 of them planted in this line right here. And it's also with high bush cranberries, and there's ribes, and there's a red prairie plum growing on it there. I'm sure I got other things in there too. Oh, there's the apple tree. I don't want to plant apple trees no more, but that one came from Buzz Fervor. He said it, the apples taste like cinnamon. Just some wild thing he found. So, there's hazelnuts here. There's a sour cherry tree right there. I got two of them growing together. It's going to have its best crop this year so far. But believe it or not, well, it's easy to believe. This used to be just a backyard with long grass. Just a whole big backyard of long grass. Then I planted 10 apple trees, and 4 of them survived. This is one of them right here. So for a long time, I had, starting at 10 and then worked down to 4 apple trees. This apple tree's been grafted with about 10 or 12 different varieties. But I planted that apple tree in the year 2000 or somewhere like that. But now look at it. It's a freaking production jungle. Yeah. I got some cup plants growing here in the shade. What they do is they collect water, and insects and the birds can land on here and get some water. Cup plant. These are Asian pears. There's, I think, 4 different varieties of Asian pears grafted onto this. This is a rootstock.
There's that cherry tree that's going to have more cherries on it than it ever has before. There's two of them growing together. See, there's one here, there's one here. You can see the cherries. This is just a sour cherry. The whole tree is full of it this year. I don't see as many kirk beetle bites, but there's one right there. You see the mark? That's from a kirk beetle. Gotta out cherry them. Well, next year we're gonna, hopefully by next year I'll have my chicken coop done and we'll do an experiment with chickens in here and we'll see if they eat the kirk beetles. Okay, starting to sprinkle out here again. Ooh, look at the baby robin. So, I better go back in the house. I can make a movie. It's probably about 5:30 already. I normally don't start coffee till about 6. Maybe it's 6. Maybe I'll just have a little early coffee. Oops. Okay, thanks for watching.
Yes. Coffee time.